They wanted to find out the number of moves it would take to solve the most difficult combination. And this number would be called God's number. If you had perfect knowledge of how to do the Rubik's Cube, you would be able to solve the most difficult position in its perfect, most efficient algorithm.
Obviously, it could, if you get a solved cube and you twist one bit, you've just got to twist it back. So it could be one, or it could be two twists, or it could be five or so on. But what's the most you're going to need? And it turns out, I mean, for a long time we didn't know.
So they knew that the number of combinations for the Rubik's Cube was this huge number. It was 43 quintillion. And if you turn a piece 17 times, if you do 17 moves, the number of combinations you can reach is less than this massive number, 43 quintillion. So if you want to be able to solve all combinations, it's definitely more than 17, because there's some that you can't even reach. They managed to work out that it was less than 30. And over the years, they started to whittle this down closer and closer.
As you can tell, I'm not really fast, but I'm not too slow either.
It was 2010 was the first time we actually knew for sure. No matter how much you scramble up a Rubik's Cube, you can solve it in 20 or fewer twists. It's often called God's number. And it's called God's number because you'd have to be some kind of omniscient being to work out those 20 moves. It's just this, it's so difficult to calculate what those moves are.
I mean, I couldn't look at a cube and say, oh, I need to do these 12 moves or whatever. But there are people who can. So they do Rubik's Cube solving competitions, and they have obviously speed challenges, and so you can solve it the fastest. But one of the other things that they do is a kind of efficient solve competition. And the competition there is look at a Rubik's Cube and then just write down a list of moves that will solve it. The world record for that is 23 moves, and obviously that was for a particular scramble of the cube, and it may have been that the actual most efficient way to solve that was fewer than 20, but a human can look at it and actually write down a list of 23, which I think is probably more impressive than people who can solve it really quickly.
You might think, well, how do we know? How do we know that? Did we just check all 43.25 billion different ways of solving it? And we effectively did that.
A move, by the way, is a quarter turn, or a quarter turn the other way, or half turn. That counts. So anything that you move counts as a move. All right, so a quarter turn, or a half turn. Those all count as one move.
You guys got the Rubik's Cube, and they started to look at all the possible combinations, and they realized that actually, you don't have to check all of them, because some of them are the same. And so they used arguments from symmetry, saying, in fact, being mixed up this way is actually the same as being mixed up that way. It's the same way to solve it, and so on and so on. And so that they managed to whittle down the number of ones they have to check. And this is one of those wonderful things where you do a proof by exhaustion.
They found a very difficult position. It was called the superflip. Now, the superflip is essentially completely solved, except each edge position was flipped over. Now that would be a very difficult position to solve. They realized that you could solve that position, the super flip, in 20 moves, and they proved that you couldn't do it in anything less than 20 moves. So you couldn't do it in 19 or 18, nothing less. So 20 moves. So they thought, great, maybe 20 is God's number.
And to do a proof by exhaustion, you have to do two things. You've got to, first of all, reduce the number of cases you need to check as much as you can. Secondly, you've got to get very clever ways of checking them. And so they got better and better computer programs and also more and more powerful computers till it got to, they just crossed. So they'd reduced the number of cases far enough, they had a fast enough computer with a smart enough program to check that many, and they could run it. And I've been to the place where they actually did the computation. It was at the Google headquarters in San Francisco, well, just outside San Francisco. And Google, because it's run by benevolent nerds, let people use their mind-bogglingly powerful computer. I mean, the amount of computer power that Google has is phenomenal. They don't use all of it all the time. And so if you come up with an interesting enough reason, they will let you come and play around on their incredible computer processing power. You got to prove that your code's not going to run amok, et cetera, et cetera. And that's what these guys did. They had their code that checked the reduced number of cases. They ran it on the Google servers, and they did. They exhaustively checked, and we know now for a fact
that God's number is 20. Every Rubik's puzzle can be solved in 20 or fewer moves.
I am actually involved at the moment in an attempt to set the world record for the most people solving Rubik's Cube simultaneously. So we're going to try and get 2,000 school students into the O2 venue in London, and we're going to try and break the simultaneous solving world record. And it's for a charity. So the DePaul charity have organised this. Rubik's are sponsoring it, and any school in the UK can enter. It's on the 21st of November. So if you go to the DePaul website, or I imagine this is the internet, we can probably hyperlink this information beneath the video. Schools can get involved. I'm involved. It's kind of the charity that I do charity work for, because it's to stop young people becoming homeless, which I think is fair enough. I'm hosting the event, so I will be there on the 21st, wandering around talking about maths and how wonderful it is. And I'm developing resources. So I've developed videos and worksheets for teachers to use to teach students how to solve Rubik's Cubes.